Good morning. Today is the second lecture of our optimization course, and it will be dedicated to derivatives of multivariate functions. First derivative gradient and vector of gradient, and second derivative Hessian matrix. And first, let me remind you basic facts about the differentiation of function of one variable. So suppose we have a function of one variable, and here is its graph. How can we define its derivative? Suppose we are in some point x0, and let build a tangent line to the graph of our function, and let give some increment to our argument. We will call it dx. Let me try to make proportional picture. We do some increment dx, and then we consider two values. First of all, increment of our function, and we call it delta f. And other important thing is increment of linear model of our function, increment of this tangent line, and this we will call df. And we know from basic analysis that when dx goes to zero, becomes infinitely small, then I can write symbolically in this way: the delta f is equal to df to some plus some infinitely small o small of dx. It O small means that infinitely small of highest order than dx. It means the ratio between this value and dx goes to zero as dx goes to zero. It's, you can think dx is epsilon, then this is, for example, epsilon squared. And okay, and what is df? Df is called differential of f. Informally, we can say that differential of f is a linear part of function increment. And also we know from basic analysis that actually the slope of this linear approximation, the tangent of this angle, is a derivative of f. So I can say that df is f prime, for example, x0 multiplied by dx. this. These are very, very basic things, but I needed them to come to multivariate function, which maybe you remember a bit less. Okay. And for multivariate function of several variables, we have very, very similar story. I plot the example of two variables, x1 and x2, and this is my function. And suppose this is a surface of three-dimensional surface, a graph of this function. And suppose I am staying at some point x0, and here is value of the function at x0, and I very symbolically will draw a tangent plane which touches, I'm not sure how the picture is successful, but you should understand that there is a tangent plane which touches this surface. And this plane is a linear function of two variables, x1 and x2. And if I do some arbitrary increment to x, some arbitrary vector dx, and I look back onto this tangent plane at this new point, value of linear function, of my linear approximation, then this difference will give me function differential. On the other hand, you remember from analysis, and this may be easily derived from this notion of tangent plane, but I will write you just final expression. You know the notion of total differential. Total differential. Suppose that I have a function f of x1, x2, xn. Then the the theorem, you can think of total differential, says us that if I give some increment dx, that means that for every component I give some increment, it will be projections of this vector dx, then differential of f will be a partial derivative df by dx1 multiplied by dx1 increment of this variable or component dx1 of vector dx, which is the same, plus df dx2 multiplied by dx2 and so on till variable xn. And now I can write this in a compact form, which will be very, very useful. I will write in this way. Let me continue here. This is equal to scalar product or inner product of two vectors. The first vector is vector of my partial derivatives. Df by dx1, df dx2, and so on till df by dxn. And the second vector will be dx1, dx2, and so on, dx1, dx2, and so on. I wrote right thing. Yes, scalar product of two vectors, it's a first component of first vector by first of second, plus second by second, and so on. It's exactly this expression. And now I do just denote. I denote this vector as nabla f of x, and also sometimes I will write g of x. And this is gradient of multivariate function, vector column of its partial derivative, gradient of f. I didn't write here arguments, but actually it's you should remember at some concrete point, for example at point x no x zero where we are staying. And okay, this is actually our vector dx, which we already used. And this gives me definition. What is gradient of multivariate function? It's just column vector of its derivatives. But also, this equality gives me important alternative definition of the gradient. I will call it external definition of the gradient. And I will say gradient is such a vector that differential of function is equal to this vector g of x inner product with dx. So if I have a function and I am able to build linear approximation, or in some other way to say given vector dx what will be df, this dependence is linear, and the vector which I will get in this dependence exactly will be a gradient of the function at given point. And as you will see later, this external definition is very useful. It will help us to build gradients of very complicated functions, while going just by a partial derivative will be too much more complicated way. So, gradient as a vector column of partial derivatives has also one more very important geometrical interpretation. Suppose we have a function of two variables for purpose of my picture, and suppose it's like a geographic map which has level lines. I will draw level lines of my function, and so on. It shows points which are on the same elevation of the same function value. And suppose that we are in some arbitrary point, again, for example, some x0, and suppose this function is growing towards the center of this picture, then we will show this later. The gradient is a vector which shows a direction of fastest ascent of the function, fastest growth of the function, and this is g of x0, or nabla f I could write, x, let me put index here. And it is orthogonal to the tangent line to the level set. Or, shortly saying, maybe not very rigorously, orthogonal to the level set. And also, we will ask the following question. How our function behaves along some arbitrary line? I can draw a line, and okay, now my point x0 will be here, and I consider a function f of x0 plus some directional vector of this line, for example, this is vector r, alpha multiplied by r. So x0 is vector, r is vector, alpha is scalar. Alpha says how far I go along the direction of r. And I will denote it just phi of alpha. And my question will be, what is the derivative phi prime of alpha? At the initial point, when I am staying at x0, it means that alpha is 0. And this is what we will call directional derivative. I will write it here. Directional derivative. Of f, say in the point f, no, x0 in direction r. Direction r. And I will denote this directional derivative as f with index r at x0. I can also write it will help in our derivation, that is d by d alpha f x0 plus alpha r. All this actually the same. And this is our definition. Put it into frame. It's a very important notion and we will use it heavily in the future. But now my question is, if I know gradient of my function f of x at point x0, can I know what is directional derivative in arbitrary direction r? And to answer this question, I could write actually it's in very simple way explicitly what are coordinates of r and give my final answer. But I like to return again to our basic notion of differential, which will help us in deriving derivatives of in various cases. So let's see what is the differential of x of f. I know. We already know that df is a scalar product. G gradient of x. I can write this transpose is instead of using sign of inner product. G transpose dx. And now I say that my x is here. I denote this as x. Just here x0. Okay? And if this is x, what is dx when I change lambda? Alpha. Because I am interested in derivative with respect to alpha. And my dx is just d alpha multiplied by r. And then I can take d alpha outside of this inner product, and this will give me d alpha multiplied by g transpose. I will not write r argument. G transpose r. So I have a function of one variable. Now, of one variable alpha. And I have df is d alpha multiplied by some number. Then, of course, f prime with respect to alpha. Rigorously would be write that this is d phi, because phi is function of one argument, but d phi is the same as df when I change alpha. So d phi by d alpha is equal just g transpose, and this is exactly what I need, phi prime. So I write it finally that FR, what I got, FR prime at x0 is just equal to g of x0 transpose multiplied by r. And this is basic and very important formula. So directional derivative of a function in direction r is just a scalar product of gradient with this direction. Now we are ready to introduce notion of Hessian. This is the second derivative of multivariate function. And good general picture. Let's get back for a second to function of one variable. So, like we told, the differential of a function of one variable is just its derivative multiplied by dx. And derivative itself is a function of x. And differential of derivative is second derivative multiplied by dx. In similar way, we can act for multivariate functions, so many variables. In this case, df is gradient g transpose of x multiplied by dx. It was our definition of gradient. And if we try to act in similar way, we will say that differential of gradient put attention that gradient is a vector. So it's something, so differential of gradient is also vector. So we should have a map from dx to dg.
It should be a matrix.
And this matrix is called matrix of Hessian. So it's h of x multiplied by dx. So h is a matrix. Hessian matrix. And also, as we denote the gradient as nabla f, h is often denoted as nabla squared f. And as we called this type of expression external definition of gradient, this is external definition of Hessian. This is external definition of Hessian. So the Hessian is a matrix which, being multiplied by dx, gives us the differential of gradient. And in the same fashion, like we got the internal definition of gradient as a column of a first partial derivative, we will show now that the Hessian is a matrix of second partial derivative. So it's like D to F dx1 squared, I could write D to F, and here how I did it, dx1 dx2 d2f dx1 dxn, and here in symmetric fashion d2f dx2 dx1 d2f dx2 dxn and so on up to the last term d2f dxn dxn. And put attention that Hessian is a symmetric matrix. Because for regular function, mixed derivatives, the value of mixed derivative doesn't depend on order of differentiation. Okay. Here I wrote offline several formulas which will show us that the external definition of Hessian and internal definition that we suggested, they do not contradict, they correspond to each other. How can we see this? I am looking at first row of the Hessian matrix, and what is this first element? This is if I take first derivative with respect to x1 and differentiate it once again with respect to x1. What is the first derivative with respect to x1? This is g1. This is first element of gradient. I can write a gradient vector g as its components g1 till gn. What they are? Df dx1 df by dxn. Okay, so if I take this first component and differentiate with respect to dx1, I get exactly this first term. If I differentiate it with respect to x2, I get the second term, and so on. So in this way, I can write this Hessian matrix a bit differently than in the beginning. Why this is useful for me? Because actually, G is not just a vector, it's a function of x. It's g of x. Gradient is a function of x. So I have g1 of x, gn of x. G is a vector function of x, but every component is a scalar function, which we already know, and we know to differentiate it. This is a scalar function of many variables. So this scalar function has its own gradient. We denote it as a nabla. Why I wrote? Yeah. We denote it as a nabla G1. So what written in first row, this is a gradient of G1, yes? Is d g1, first partial derivative of g1 with respect to first variable, second variable, and so on. So instead of column, we took row, that's why I wrote transpose. And now we are ready to see what is the product of Hessian with vector dx. How I multiply matrix by a vector. I multiply first row by a vector and get a result at the first position. So dg1 delta g1 transpose multiplied by dx. Gradient of element of gradient. Gradient of this function transpose multiplied by dx. This is a differential of this function. It's by definition of gradient. So here we took gradient of first element of our gradient. So this will give us dg1. And so on. This is dg2 and this is dgn. And finally all this vector components wise differentials of gradient. This is dg, differential of gradient. This is just by definition. In this way we define the differential of a vector. So this finally what we got, h multiplied by dx is dg. This was our external definition of Hessian. So now we see that internal definition and the external correspond to each other. Okay, and now we are ready to introduce and calculate the second directional derivative. So I just return fast to the first directional derivative, which we already have. So if I am at the point x0 and see what's going in direction r, and consider this function phi of alpha as f of x0 plus alpha r, then derivative of this function at the point alpha equal to zero, sorry. is called directional derivative of x at the point x0 in direction r, and we learn that is just inner product of gradient at this point x0 with vector of direction r. Now, the second derivative is in very similar way. So we already defined our function of alpha. It's just the second derivative of alpha at the point alpha zero. And this is how it's denoted. Okay, so it's just second derivative with respect to alpha f plus x, f of x zero plus alpha r. And for my derivation, how can I compute this value when I know Hessian? It's convenient to say me that the second derivative is the derivative of first derivative. And this is what written here. And I remember, and I will substitute, that the first derivative is r transpose multiplied by gradient at the point at some current point x. Actually, it's not x0, it's my current x. Okay. So, and now I say, as usually, to calculate derivative, it's convenient for me first to write down differential. So, if I have this expression, some function is a vector of constant vector transpose g. Differential of this expression, because this is constant vector of coefficients, is just r transpose multiplied by dg. And now we remember from external definition of the Hessian that dg is this is dg, okay, Hessian multiplied by dx. I only need to know what is dx caused by change of alpha. But okay, so my x is x0 plus alpha r, so what will be dx? Dx is will be just d alpha multiplied by r. D alpha multiplied by r. R d alpha. I substitute it here. And I get this simple expression. So this is dependence on of df, scalar df, on scalar, sorry, scalar df prime, on scalar d alpha. So the derivative of f prime, it's my second derivative that I need, will be just this value which multiplies d alpha. It follows from definition of differential of a function of one variable. Now, alpha is my single variable. So, and this gives me finally f double prime r of x0 is just this expression. R transpose h of x0 multiplied by r. Such a quadratic form with respect to matrix H. Okay. Now we will consider several examples of gradients of function of several variables. We will start with a trivial claim that if you have a linear operator, so x and y, maybe also y, maybe also a vector, then differential of y is just a multiplied by dx, and one obtains this trivially just from the definition. So you should subtract from a of x plus dx minus a of x. And then we are ready to look at the gradient of linear function. If you have such simple function, f of x is just b transpose x. One can just take internal definition of gradient and trivially get that gradient is vector b. But we train ourselves to use the external definition of gradient. So, what is df? Df is just b transpose dx. It's linear function of this particular case of linear operator. Okay, and then now we just compare this expression with the non-external external definition of gradient, that df is g transpose dx for any dx. And those two can be true for every dx only if b transpose and g transpose is the same. So we conclude that the g is equal to b. Okay. A bit more challenging example. Quadratic form. When f of x is x transpose ax, where x is a quadratic matrix. Actually, I didn't write it here, but you should know possibly, and if somebody doesn't remember, he can easily get it. What is the final expression for this in coordinate vast form? It's just some, let me write it here somewhere, sum of aij xi xj, where aij are elements, sum over all elements of matrix A. Okay, again, one can try directly to differentiate, compute partial derivatives of this sum and get finally to the gradient. And let's try to do the same by external definition. So we need a differential of this expression. And we often will meet an expression where x is present in different places. And by ideas of total differential, one can say that differential of any complicated expression of x can be obtained in this way. We consider x as constant in all places except of one, and compute differential of this term. Then in the second place, and then if there will be more places, so on. So what do we do? We just think about this as constant, and then we get differential in this way, dx transpose multiplied by x. Now I think about this as constant and get this term. So this is my df. But to obtain gradient, I like to have dx on one side. Here is on different sides. But you see here, this expression is scalar. Yes, a multiplied by dx is a vector, x transpose is another vector, so this is a scalar. It should be scalar. And I can take transpose of it. If I take transpose by rule of transposition of matrix product, I will get something which you can do by yourself, and finally get dx transpose out of parentheses and get a plus a transpose here multiplied by x. And x I also can take out of parentheses. So something which has scalar product with dx in order to get df is gradient, like we already told. So we just have here expression for gradient, and I wrote it here. And the important particular case when A is symmetric, so A and A transpose is the same,
It's just 2ax.
So, just to memorize things, if I would have a scalar function, it would be ax squared, if x would be scalar. And then derivative is 2ax, like we remember. So it corresponds. Now let us try to look at Hessian of this quadratic form. I just remember this expression. The differential of gradient is Hessian multiplied by dx. I have expression for gradient. What is differential of this expression? Just this matrix multiplied by dx. What is written here. So I compare those two expressions and conclude that this is Hessian. H is A plus A transpose, and in case of symmetric matrices, 2A. So you see this technique of considering external definitions of gradient and Hessian works very, very nice in the case of complicated matrix functions. Those are simple, but now we will consider a bit more challenging example, neural networks. Before neural networks, we should consider two other topics, Taylor expansion and matrix functions. So, what is the Taylor expansion of a multivariate function? I actually will give here not all expansion, but till second order term. It's written here. So if I am staying at point x and make some increment r, then f of x plus r will be f of x plus g transpose r plus half of quadratic function based on Hessian. What is the idea of how can I get this kind of expressions? Let me denote this function, this part, just say quadratic part, as a function of r. I will write it as q of r. And the idea, if I will plot, for example, my original function f as a function of r, my increment r, then I stay at original point at x. I stay at x, then r is 0. And what I try to do, I build a quadratic function, and this function I will call q of r. Such function that touches my actual function f at the point r0. So it has the same value, the same first derivative, and also the same curvature as my function f, means the same second derivative. Let us check whether I satisfied all those requirements. So I like that when r is 0, f of x is equal q of r, or q of 0 will be the same. Gradient g of x is equal here I will use nabla. Actually here it also nabla f of x, yes, it is convenient now to use nabla on both parts. it's gradient of Q of R, and also Hessian Nabla squared f of x is equal Nabla squared Q of R. So those three things we should check when R is zero. Let's try to check it. So, when R is zero, what will be the value of this expression? Of course, this will be zero, this zero. Okay, f of x. The first one is satisfied. What will be gradient? Gradient with respect to R of this expression. Let's see. Gradient Q of R. This is linear function with respect to R. In the, my case, R is variable, x is a constant. So this is some constant vector multiplied by R. So this term will be, give me just this vector. So it will be g of x. I almost satisfied. But I also have this expression which might contribute to gradient. So it's plus, so we already know that quadratic form H is symmetric matrix, and here is half, it cancels, it's just HR. But we check when R zero. So HR is zero when R zero. Okay, the second requirement is also satisfied. And of course, second derivative, this is constant, this is linear function, the second derivative, zero. And the second derivative of this term, we told that for symmetric matrix is 2h, and this cancels, so we get h. So Nabla squared Q of R. Sorry, Q of R is just equal to H of X. Yeah, I can write here H of X. Saved a bit my writing, but it should be H of X. Okay, so you see, I really built quadratic function which has the same value, slope and curvature as my original function. And this is gives me three first terms of Taylor expansion. We will not use other terms, but those three we will use heavily in optimization algorithms. Okay. And till now we considered multivariate function of vectors, and now it's important to consider also function of matrices. So I have a matrix variable X with elements Xij, M by N matrix, and scalar function of X. And one can define a gradient as matrix of partial derivatives. So instead of being vector of partial derivatives, now it's matrix and first partial derivatives with respect to every element of matrix X. And we will see in the moment that this definition again stays together with the external definition of gradient as differential being scalar product of gradient is dx. And for this I just remind you for a second scalar products of matrices. So if I have two matrices A and B, then I can define the scalar product or inner product as a scalar product of two long vectors with elements A and B, or in other words, sum of over I and J, A I J B I J. And we already told that this can be expressed as a trace A transpose B. And this is very, very important formula for our derivation. Okay. And now we are ready to write what will be df if we define the gradient in this way. So df, actually independently on definition of our gradient, if I have a function of many variables, then I have formula of total differential. So it will be just a sum over all variables I and j, partial derivative df dx ij multiplied by differential of this variable dx ij. But also I can write it as a trace G transpose G of X transpose DX. So what I will need, I need to define a matrix dx, okay? So my matrix dx, of course, in trivial ways, matrix as dx11, dx12, dx21, and so on. So what is a trace G transpose dx? It's exactly what written here. On the other hand, by definition of scalar product of matrices, this scalar product of my G with dx. So again, I just exactly in the same framework as I was in vector case with the external definition of gradient. So df is g of x dx. And if I have a complicated matrix expression, and if I am able to give expression for its differential, I just will find the gradient. And now we will see this on example of neural networks. And now let's look at one more example. Finding gradient of a neural network. We already learned in the first lecture an example of neural network, and here we even will consider more simple neural network with only one layer of neurons, one layer of nonlinear sigmoidal functions phi. So this is very simple expression of function of neural network of its input x and weights w, v and biases of first layer of neuron b
Actually, mathematician doesn't need to think about all this structure. It's enough to see this formula. So I have some function where output will be obtained by this matrix W multiplied by x plus some vector b. I take vector element wise function, so I denote this inner part as vector u, and I take element wise function phi. So this is vector, this is also vector, multiplied by v transpose gives me some number, some scalar. And I will be interested for optimization, for learning weights of neural networks. We need to know its derivatives with respect to w, b, and v. And we will consider now in the class only gradient with respect to w, and I will leave for your homework remaining things that are a bit simpler. Okay, so how do we start? Try to build differential of this expression as a function of differential of some argument. For example, we first will consider w. What I'm ready to do right now, it's say if I know du, then what will be d phi? Phi is a vector function of u. D phi will be a vector with such components, phi prime of u1, du1, and so on. And I tend in this course, like you see, write everything in matrix form. So it's convenient instead of this to write diagonal matrix with this derivatives, scalar derivatives on the diagonal, multiplied by vector du1, dun. And I also will denote this diagonal matrix as a phi prime capital. So what I have is d phi is phi prime multiplied by du. Very simple expression. Okay, and we're almost ready to write differential of our overall function, because you see u is function of w, and what I can say is that du caused by w with index w is just dw transpose x. Okay, and now I am ready to write df. So what will be df? Df is equal v transpose multiplied by d phi. V transpose multiplied by d phi. And a substitute is just v transpose phi prime capital by du, and du I already have, d w transpose x. Not very complicated expression, but what we really want, we like to express df as scalar product of something with dw. And here in this expression, dw is inside of some chain. I like to put it somehow outside to see scalar product. How can I do it? This expression is a scalar. Do you see it? This is a vector by matrix. So it's vector by the diagonal matrix, again vector. And here by transpose of some other vector from the left, it's scalar. So I can write instead of this expression that it's trace of this expression, because trace of the scalar, it's the scalar itself. But under trace, I have commutativity, and I will use it. So it's trace of this expression. V transpose phi prime dw transpose x. And now, under trace, I have commutativity. I can put x here, and dw transpose will be outside. Okay? So it's equal to trace. So I change places of those two matrices. Okay? Those are A and B. My A and B. Trace AB is equal to trace BA. Okay? So what I get? Trace XV transpose phi prime D W transpose. And what is my final goal? I remember that AB inner product of two matrices is a trace A transpose B. A transpose B. I try to get this kind of expression. I almost there. Actually, let me see whether I understand it right. Yes, actually, no problem. So we just swap dw transpose in this expression. Trace. So again, we use once more commutativity on the trace. Dw transpose and xv transpose phi prime. Did I get things right? Yes. So and this is just inner product. Inner product of dw with this matrix x v transpose phi prime. So we of course as we usually do, we say also I know that df is inner product of g with dw. Let's write at everywhere index w. We compute now gradient with respect to w. Okay, so we compare those two expressions. So this my df and this my df. And from those two we conclude, how I say, two arrows. From those two I conclude that g with respect to w, let me put index w here, is just equal x v transpose phi prime. It's very simple and compact expression, and believe me, if you would open here parentheses and write down the function as a multiple sum and so on, and start computing partial derivatives, you will get a much more complicated process. So this again, this external definition of gradient via differential gives us really, really simple and nice way to compute gradients of complicated functions. And actually, I leave for your homework to compute gradient with respect to B. and with respect of f, and gradient with respect to v. So this will be your homework. Much simpler part, but you need it to get some training.